Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everybody here this morning. There's lots of announcements, so make sure you take note in your bulletin. There's lots of inserts in there as well, different things coming up and going on, so make sure you take note of all that. A few of the things that I wanted to highlight will be Friday night. There'll be a Bible Jeopardy for all ages, and that starts at 6 o'clock here at the church, so everybody's invited. There'll be food, and there'll be games, and so just a good time. Just encourage you to come out for that. The mobile food truck has moved, so the normal truck that would be here this Thursday has been postponed, and it'll actually be here on March the 2nd, and so there'll technically be two food trucks in the month of March and none in February, so make sure you take note of that. Next week is the annual business meeting, and says everything is going to be supplied. You do not need to bring a dish to pass, and we will have homemade pie for dessert. So, I mean, if that isn't enough to make it worth sticking around for the annual business meeting, I don't know what is. But you don't have to bring anything. Everything will be provided. And we do encourage you to stick around for the business meeting. Even if you're not a member, you're more than welcome. You wouldn't be able to vote, but you still can see what's going on at the church, and we'd appreciate you being here. We have a baptism service that we're planning for in the spring, and so anybody that might be interested in baptism or becoming a member, we've already got a few people interested, so just let Pastor or one of the deacons know so we can be working on that. And we also have a Pinewood Derby coming up here in a couple weeks on March the 4th. And so if you haven't had a chance to get a car and start working on that, make sure you do. It's a great opportunity to reach out to somebody. Could be an extended family member or a neighbor kid or somebody that doesn't come to church, but you might have an opportunity to make a Pinewood Derby car with them, and something that all the kids always enjoy. Thank you.
And one more announcement. When we get to March 5th, which will be our next Communion Sunday, we are returning with Communion to our regular Deaconess Fund offering. The regular offerings are going to continue to be in the boxes at the doors, but the Deaconess Fund will now take its monthly offering again starting in March. So if you want to be prepared for that, a little advance warning. As we pray together this morning, there are lots of needs on our list, but to add to that, Tom Moore is having gallbladder surgery this morning. Pray for him. Ask God to provide for him right now. And Don Sorter did have surgery yesterday, so pray for his recovery. So let's join together, let's pray together, and ask God to provide. Lord, we come to you this morning thanking you for the answered prayer that you've already provided, for the things you've already done, for the blessings you've already granted to us. And we come today looking to you for the needs that are yet before us, the things that we look upon on a list, and in a sense, in a way, while there are many people here, and time will not allow us to name every name that's listed here, you know every name that's listed here. You know the person and the situation that they're enduring, whether it be a physical problem, for those who might have spiritual needs, the need for wisdom or for your guidance. We know that you are very aware of each need that is before us, and we bring them before you. We think of Tom Orr in surgery right now, praying for him. We think of Don Sorter recovering from surgery. We think of those who today are recovering from illnesses, those who are planning ahead for surgery, both listed before us. And for those who are in long-term situations, be it cancer or some other long-term illness, and for their families, we just come before you and lay all the needs of these folks and their families, their caregivers, and each situation that they have before you. We thank you for the opportunity we have to trust you in needs that are around us, before us, and that affect us. For other type of needs that we might have, for the needs that we have for wisdom, guidance, perhaps there are those with financial need today, perhaps there are those who have spiritual needs, struggling against some temptation or sin, perhaps there are those today who just need to be encouraged, feeling discouraged by circumstances. We pray that by the Spirit of God, you might meet all those needs and provide through Christ. We thank you that through Christ, not only do we have forgiveness of sin through what Jesus did for us on the cross, but we have the daily needs that we have met through our Savior, the one who loved us and gave his life for us. We ask as well for our nation, for our country, for the spiritual needs of America, for the needs for our leaders to have godly wisdom in choices that they make, for the need that we have around this world and for our missionaries who've gone around this world to share the gospel. We just pray that you would minister. We thank you for providing for those who are allowed with the week of vacation for some of the schools to get away. We pray for their safe journey for those who might be traveling this week. And we also pray that you would just bless us as we worship together. And now as we take a look at our own lives and bring our own requests before you in just a moment of silence, we pray that you will minister these needs in the same way that you minister to the needs we pray together for. We bring them all through our Savior Jesus. Amen.
This morning's scripture reading can be found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, if you'd like to follow along as I read. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you. We'll have our kids come up for our children's chat this morning. All right. Yes, I brought something with me. I'll show it to you in a minute. The other night at volleyball, we have adult volleyball, the other night we were playing volleyball, and we got into a discussion about shoes. Amy started it. And she was talking about how she can't find a pair of shoes that is fit for soccer, indoor soccer. And that got me thinking. You know, it only takes something very little to get me thinking. I just don't think much. But that got me thinking about my children's chat. So I brought one of my pairs of shoes. But shoes are specific sometimes to the thing you want to do with them. These shoes that I'm going to show you would not work for volleyball, and they won't work for indoor soccer. And I've actually used them for a couple things, but here they are. Anybody recognize what you might be able to do with these?
Jog.
No, jog. Well, you can try. What would you think? Outdoor soccer. That's one thing I've used these for. More recently, I've used it for something else. Hiking? No, I don't think I'd go hiking with those. Maybe you could, but I wouldn't. Yeah? Baseball? You probably could for baseball, but I haven't. We played touch football with these most recently that I've wore these, and that was a little while ago. These are cleats. And I can tell you this, for any indoor activity, these don't work. As a matter of fact, on indoor activities, these are most uncomfortable. Your feet, your ankles, your legs, your hips, and everything else in between will ache if you wear these very long and try to run around on hard surfaces because they are made to sink into the mud. And of course, we know soccer is a typical fall sport in New York. There's mud, lots of it, and football as well. So they're made for that, but they're not made for other things. Now, there's other shoes. Somebody mentioned hiking. I don't happen to have a pair of hiking shoes, but they make shoes that are equipped to help you to hike. They don't quite have as much grip as this, but they will get you to some traction on the dirt, and they're called hiking shoes. Now, it's interesting that Amy mentioned indoor soccer shoes, volleyball shoes. What other kinds of shoes are there that you might want to wear? Yeah? Work shoes. Yes, I have a set of those at home as well. I could have brought them, but they're too heavy. Iron-toed shoes. I have them left over from my days of cutting firewood. I always wore work shoes with iron toes because I'd rather dull the chain than dull my foot. So I always wore those. I also have another kind of shoe at home that I didn't bring. You probably wouldn't want me to bring. What do you think? Ah, here we go. I didn't bring... ballet, jazz, and tap shoes. I own none of them. I couldn't bring them, but you could have brought them. And they won't do well for playing outdoor soccer, though, will they? No. I have barn boots I could have brought, too, that I go into the barn with my chickens. And you didn't want me to bring those this morning. But I could have brought those, too. I have barn boots. Anything else? Basketball shoes are different as well, yes. And some people wear the basketball shoes that certainly come up over their ankles so they don't sprain their ankles. And probably they're not as good for soccer because they're just too tall. Any others, quickly? Running shoes. Yep. The grips to run with. Running shoes. Yeah, that's another kind. He goes zoom in those. Indoor soccer. That's what Amy's saying. She can't find those. You need to get together with Amy and help her find some indoor soccer shoes. And one more. Church shoes. Well, that's what I'm wearing today. These I typically don't wear anywhere else because the heel on these hurt my foot if I wear them longer than a couple hours. So they're church shoes. Church shoes. You got church shoes on. All these different shoes are set for a purpose, aren't they? So what does this have to do with anything at all? Well, there's a verse I wanted to share. It's from Ephesians. It's talking about the armor of God, and it talks about your feet and your shoes. And it says, having shod or put on your feet the preparation of the gospel of peace. So gospel shoes. Anybody have any of those? Uh-oh. Nobody. We have soccer. We have basketball. Hiking. Barn. Work. We got it covered, except what's this talking about? What is a gospel shoe? Well, a gospel shoe isn't a shoe like this. It talks about more where your feet are. You know, because we've talked around this, where your feet are. Where are your feet when you're wearing this? Not in here, out in a field. Where are your feet when you're wearing a barn boot? Not in here, out in the barn. Where are your feet when you're wearing a work shoe? Working with maybe a chainsaw or something. Every shoe isn't designed the same because it's made for where you're going to be with it. And so this talks about where are you going to be with your feet? Well, this verse says, be with your feet at a place where you can help others and maybe give to them the Lord's truth that Jesus died for them. Sometimes, and we don't need, by the way, a particular kind of shoe. You know what you can with this verse do? You can do this in a soccer shoe to a soccer teammate and tell them about Jesus. You can do this in a basketball shoe, talking to one of your basketball teammates about the Lord. You can do this hiking, talking to somebody about Jesus on a hike. You can do this in a barn boot if you're in the barn and somebody else other than my chickens are there and tell them about Jesus. You can do this in a work shoe. You can do this in a church shoe. You can do this in any shoe. God says, take your feet and whatever you're wearing on them, go with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So, Amy, you inspired this whole lesson by one statement. I can't find any soccer shoes for indoor soccer. Take your shoes, your feet, and take your feet to somebody who needs the Lord. And that'll be a great use of whatever shoe you're wearing. You can head back to Children's Church or your parents. So, Amy, you got to inspire me again this week for next Sunday. All right. And off they go that away. And off we go to Thessalonians. We have started, as of last week, a new series that will run between last week and Easter, and maybe a little longer. We'll see how long it runs, on prophecy. But not just to learn all the facts of prophecy that we might know them in our head and say, isn't that interesting? But that the facts of prophecy that God has given us, things that are yet to come to this world, have some kind of an application for us who live today. Last week we talked about the basic beginning that the coming of our Savior is imminent, meaning that the Lord can come at any time, that there's nothing that we can find in the Scripture that has to happen before the Lord can come, thus we could say Jesus can't come yet. So as we looked at that last week, and we looked at that from the perspective that Paul, Peter, James, and John all believed it, we come today to see what it is. What does the beginning of Christ's coming look like? And if you were paying attention to the verses that Gary read this morning, you will find this is where we begin to look at what Jesus will do next. By the way, you can't have an imminent coming of Christ unless this event, we call it the rapture of the church, you could call it the coming together in the air, whatever you would like to call it, it has to be next because it's the only surprise. If Jesus doesn't come back till the end of 7 years of tribulation, which you find in Revelation, he can't come today because those 7 years aren't occurring and haven't occurred yet. So to have that belief that he could come at any time, you must believe that his first coming is the one that's described here. And this coming that's described in this passage is a sudden, distinct interruption of everything that's going to go down on this world that we live in. He says, I don't want you to be ignorant, brethren, in verse 13. This is for believers. Unbelievers will never have a chance of understanding this. It's for the brethren, for those who place their faith, their trust, their belief, their hope in Jesus Christ. If you have not done that, you're going to struggle to understand much of what's going to be said this morning about the coming of the Lord. Brethren, and it says concerning first those who are not with us anymore, those who are asleep, that sorrow not. Those who are not with us, if you believe that Jesus, verse 14, died and rose again, even them who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And this has never happened yet. There's no instance in human existence that could ever say, oh, that happened already. This event is going to be a life-interrupting event. Have you ever been interrupted? You know, you're just in the middle of something, and what happens? The phone rings. You get a text. An email arrives, and you get distracted. And typically, every day, how many times do you get interrupted? You can sit there and count for just a couple seconds, but it tends to be quite a few. Every once in a while, there's an interruption that's life-changing. These are numbered less, but they are life-changing. If you've ever gone to the doctor and the doctor says, I have some news for you, you better sit down. Probably the doctor is about to change something in your life. If you're a young couple and you take that little test, you know, and now the first baby's on the way, oh, life is going to change. You don't know yet how life is going to change, but it's going to change. There are once in a while a life-changing event that interrupts everything, and life changes. This world we live in, when this event comes, it will change everything. Everything will be interrupted and everything will be changed. However, as we look to this event, yet future, not happening yet, not happening this morning yet, knowing that it could happen at any time, but knowing that we've all lived a long time and it hasn't happened yet, not knowing the moment of its coming, I am guilty, or was years ago, of misinterpreting the application of this event. Who here has ever had a bad day? You ever had a bad day? How about that famous book, Very, 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 Very Bad Day? And in the midst of that very, 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 very bad day, the first time in weeks you think about, oh, if the Lord could come, today would be the day. Oh, Lord, you know, right now is good. Come on back, please. Wrong interpretation and application of these verses. You know, I used to think that. When I was a newer believer, would look to the Lord on a bad day and say, now's a great time. I will be honest with you, my first 2 or 3 years as a pastor back in the 80s, there were many days I said, Lord, now would be a great time, any time now. And then I kind of got thinking about that, and I'm thinking, you know, as God picked a time that he was going to come back, he didn't look down and say, oh, look at, you know, Charlie Robertson in 1988, You know, he's crying for me to come. I'll do it then. Nope. God doesn't plan his return on any of our good days, bad days, or indifferent days. God has picked a time, and it has nothing to do with what we're doing today. You know, the poor application of this is to think that somehow God is going to save me from my earthly misery. And he might when he does come, except guess what? We're all still waiting for his saving from our earthly misery. I've now waited in various stages of earthly bad days and good days and misery and triumph a lot of years, and I'm still here, and he hasn't saved me from any of them. I want to go back to the verse we ended on last week when John was talking about his application of the imminent coming of Christ and the coming of the Lord to meet us in the air, which will interrupt everything. And John said this, and you might remember it from last week. It says in John, 1 John 2:28, "And now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming." God isn't coming to bail me or bail you out of a hard time. He's not coming to make your way of escape. He's coming to show us by his power and giving us these verses that we can get through those hard times. The lesson is, in application, looking ahead, not God bail me out, but God help me out. You see, what kind of power does it take for the Lord Jesus Christ to leave heaven where he is now, since he's ascended there in the book of Acts, to come back to the sky, to somehow empower that every believer on the face of this planet will leave their earthly bodies and immediately soul and spirit be centered and headed upward to meet the Lord in the air. At the same time, or just before, as these verses actually say, all those who are dead in Christ will leave their earthly graves and be started upward to meet the Lord in the air. What kind of power do you think that takes? I think it takes a little bit, doesn't it? Do you think in that power there's something that you have going on in your life that's just too hard for God to do? Do you really think there's something you've got going on? You know, I just don't know that God can do that. When we have the picture of the coming of the Lord beginning, the first prophetic event that's yet to take place, that's next in line in earthly time, and it involves taking people out, souls out, the dead will be lifted up, and there's going to be a resurrection, and we're going to look at those verses in just a moment, where we're given a new body, the one that's promised to us in the verses in 1 Corinthians, and we'll read them in a moment, and that God is going to do all this. Do you think, instead of asking for escape, oh Lord, just come back today, we might better in application say, Lord, with the power that you come back, can you help me today? I think that's a much better application of the truth that we're reading. You know, we all hope to be amongst those when the Lord comes, obviously by our belief and our faith and our trust in Christ that we're going up. But there's no guarantee that if that's 122 years from now, that any of us will still be here to go up from this life. But I'm going to guarantee this, if you're a believer, you're going to go up, because you're going to come back with him, and a body's going to come up from the gravesite where you ever were laid, even the dust of a molecule that couldn't be found, and God will give you a resurrected body like the Savior's, and we'll all gather together in the sky. Every once in a while I fly to Florida. We all gather in a plane. Some of you love flying. Some of you detest flying. I know Gary Henry doesn't exactly like flying over there. It's not one of his favorite things to do. If Lupa said, I got you a gift for a Valentine's Day and it's a flight to somewhere, Gary's not impressed with that gift. He's not a flyer. And there's parts of flying that I like. I like looking out in the clouds. That I like. TSA, baggage, price. A lot of things I don't like as well as like looking out the window and seeing those clouds. Can you imagine a day without a plane, Mr. Henry, that you will be flying in those clouds? How about that? How much power does it take to fly Gary Henry up and fly him somewhere without a plane? How much power does it take to take all of us up without a plane? The application of these verses is if you can see the power of God to do this, the power of God is available to help you and I with whatever's in your life, whatever's going on. It's there to help us. And this is a statement of a promise, of a fact, of something that is to come, that when it happens, and those who are alive and remain are caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, the power to do that is unbelievably miraculous. And it's not about bailing us out. It's about reminding us until this moment comes that the same God who can do that is with us, who has said to us, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm with you in your trials. I'm with you in your hardship. I'm with you in the struggles of life. I'm there. And I'm there in the same power and have the same abilities as I'll have someday when everybody is taken to the clouds to be with me. And this interruption will interrupt the life of Christians who on that day go up. I mean, there's just no question. If you're here and this is tomorrow, we're going to be interrupted, aren't we? Everything is going to be interrupted for us who believe. It's going to interrupt more than just us who believe. Because if you understand what's happening here, that means all of us who believed will suddenly be gone. I'm talking about airline pilots. I heard this joke 30 years ago, before I ever flew in a plane, years before. They said, make sure your pilots aren't both Christians, if you're not a Christian. Sound advice, I guess, but I never felt the need, since I've been a Christian, to go in the cockpit. You know, if the Lord comes while I'm on a plane, I just have to go out on the wing, and I'm right there already. You know, I'm ready. I'm just up already. But I'd hate to think if I'm a non-believer, my pilots are leaving the plane and headed out. But think about the disruption and interruption of this world. And that's the most dramatic thing perhaps I can think of. But think about it in the simple ways. Those who wake up the day after all of us who are believers are gone may find their doctor is gone, their dentist is gone. They may find the people who plow their roads in the middle of the winter, some of them are gone. They may find that some of the police and firefighters and others who serve us are gone. There will be just constant interruption. We've gone through a time in our nation through the pandemic where now there's staffing shortages. In America, there will be lots of Christians, if it were today, that would leave. There will be other places that the interruption will be very minimal. We've looked at, and it was mentioned in Sunday school, and I had plans to mention it here this morning now. Turkey just had this terrible earthquake. The interruption on that country and Syria is just unbelievable. Turkey is the least Christian nation, perhaps, in the world. If the Lord came and took all those who believed in Turkey, they'd hardly notice because there's so few. There's far more interruption to them from an earthquake. In America, the interruption would be all of us who are believers to be gone if it's today. Now, if it's 100 years from now, who's to say what the interruption will be in any country? Because it all depends on how many Christians there really are at that point in time. But you can say this, in places on this earth, there will be terrible interruption. The world as it is known now will be interrupted to such an extent, everything will change. Very quickly, overnight, everything will change. We'll look at this next week, and I'm not looking at it today in any depth because I'm going to talk about it for about 30 minutes next week. What happens when every believer on this earth is gone? What will that mean? We'll look at that next week. I just mentioned the logistics, your doctors, your Amazon drivers, your food pantry workers, gone. Samaritan's Purse will not be coming to your relief effort. Most of their folks, I'm pretty sure, will be gone. And beyond that, there's a heartache of the judgments of God in the book of Revelation that are about to begin. But even before they begin, the interruption on this planet will be so significant and so immense if there's any number of Christians still left here that are gone. And if that's soon and if that's today, we can certainly say the interruption will be significant. What is God doing and why is God doing this? Well, Revelation 3:10, and you can look this one up later if you want, write it down, I'll read it to you quickly. Talking to the church at Philadelphia, he's talking to the church of still those who were faithful and believed, and the church of Philadelphia was a church in Revelation of that day that loved the Lord with all their heart and served him with all their soul. And he says this to them. He says, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world, to test those who dwell on the earth. God is taking those of us who are in Christ, and he is sparing us from what's to come. He's not sparing you and me from our life and our bad day to day. That is completely the wrong interpretation, application. But there is coming a day when judgment will come. And the preceding of that judgment before it hits here is God taking his own to be with him. Now, the escape we looked at last week, it's imminent, but we don't know when. You know, I'd like to say, well, I have a date now. Last night, God, just like Gary's been going through Daniel in his adult class, we just ended. And God gave Daniel lots of details, but one detail God didn't give Daniel, and Gary covered it this morning, was the date. When? When will these things take place? And he told Daniel, just sit back and wait, I'll take care of it. And he's telling us the same thing. When we say, God, when? Will I get to live all my life and still everybody be waiting for you? That's a possibility. The older I get, the more I see that possibility, because the less years I've got. The younger you are, you say, well, how is there a chance, the way this world is today, that I'm going to make it to 80 or 90 or 100 if I'm only a teenager or a college age today? I can't imagine the Lord won't be coming before I get old like that pastor up there. You know, I'll have to be gone. However, that may not be the case. We just don't know. We need to be ready. Last week we talked about the imminency of his coming, but his coming is for a purpose, and that purpose is to keep us, who at that moment are believers in Christ, in this church era and age, to keep us from a judgment and a trial that's going to come upon the whole world and test those who dwell on the earth, where everything on this earth will be utterly, completely, totally changed, literally overnight. You know, I remarked, and a lot of people remarked, remember how quickly the pandemic changed things? You know, from 2 weeks, Earl was having a Pinewood Derby, you know, and we were racing cars in the activity center. And 2 weeks later, we were locked in our houses doing nothing. In 2 weeks, just like that. It won't take 2 weeks when the Lord comes and takes his children to be with him, but what this world is thrust into a complete and total interruption. Now I want to talk about the good interruption. That's the interruption for those who've believed. And you can turn with me if you would, because we'll be there for the rest of our time today. This event is described in 1 Thessalonians. It is given details to us in 1 Corinthians, particularly chapter 15. And typically, though these are not sad verses, but starting at verse 51 of 1 Corinthians 15, these are verses I read at a graveside at a funeral. Why are we talking about funerals now? Because we're not talking about funerals. We're talking about what at a funeral is for a believer, that which they have faith to believe and hope to someday see. When the Lord comes, that which is hoped for, that which is believed, will actually take place. It will be the reality of what happens, viewed by us if we're still here, or viewed by us as we come back with the Lord and are resurrected. Notice the similarity of wording when you get to verse 51. This whole chapter of 1 Corinthians 15 talks of the resurrection. And in verse 51 it says, "Behold, I show you a mystery." A mystery is something that they could not know, they could not understand, they couldn't have any idea about unless the Lord tells us. He says, "I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or die, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality." Verse 54, "So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory." Resurrection day is the same day as rapture day. It's the same day as the meeting in the air. It's all the same. It all takes place together. The purpose of God isn't just for us to be souls and spirits that live forever in heaven with the Lord. That's a temporary state. For those of us who are created with a body, after Adam and Eve, and it looks like all of you fit that description this morning, we all have bodies to whatever extent they're healthy or lack of healthy, old, young, somewhere in between, we all have them. We're all human. We're all mortal. The mortal of this body will put on immortality. And the immortality is not the soul and spirit immortality, but it was the joining of the soul and spirit that may have already gone to be with the Lord, or maybe down here when the Lord comes, those souls and those spirits shed from this earthly body will be joined together with a resurrection body like Jesus's. You know, right now, it's easy to count. How many resurrections and bodies are there running around the universe from death down here to resurrection body somewhere? It's a real easy count, isn't it? There is one. And whose body is that? It's the one we celebrate Easter morning. Jesus came forth resurrected. And his body is the first fruits, and that's from this chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, the first fruits of all of us who will be resurrected. But none of us have been resurrected yet. None of the dead are yet resurrected to a body. Their soul and spirit is with the Lord. Now, we can get into all kinds of questions. That clock on the back of the wall says we won't answer today. Well, how does my soul recognize your soul once we get to heaven? Gary gave a great little children's message while I was gone on name tags. That's a possibility, I suppose. You know, you have a name tag. But it's a possibility intrinsically. God allows us a recognition of people one-to-one through the ages when we get to heaven, soul and spirit. But that's not our permanent place, our permanent estate. This is where we're going to end up. This is the realization of bringing us back to where we should have been the moment that a couple of folks in a Garden of Eden ate some fruit. God created us not to be disembodied souls and spirits, but to be his people of physical being, physical nature. And this new body won't be quite like this one, but it will be physical, and it won't be corruptible like this one. It won't be mortal like this one. You won't be able to kill it. You won't be able to hurt it. It won't get sick. It won't have all the problems of this one. And then we will say what? Death is swallowed up in victory. For the Christian, we live some aspects of our Christian life by faith. We have no proof. We have no sight. We have no ability to see. And resurrection is one of them. You know, I wish today I could trot out a model resurrection body. You know, would you like this one when you get to eternity? Or maybe this model. How about this model? You know, like a car. Which one would I want? You know, which body will I take? I can't even do that because there is no models. There is no resurrected human bodies kicking around that we can model them and say, well, I'd like the one there with red hair if you could give me that one. It doesn't exist. This is all belief by faith because the Word of God states it to be. Back in the Old Testament, they believed what by faith? That Jesus would come as their Messiah. And what was the fulfillment of their faith? They didn't know it. Only a few shepherds did, but he came in a manger. And that was the fulfillment of the faith of those shepherds who had believed. And later on, a whole Israel area that Jesus ministered to got to see their Messiah. And he was the example that God said this would happen, and it did. And then he was crucified, fulfilling the Old Testament, Psalm 22, Isaiah 55, 53. And he then ascended to heaven. And then he said, this is what's coming next. I will return. And the first part of his return is to bring us together in the air. And we have no proof of any of this. No proof at all. I'm telling you something that the only proof I have is God has shared it with us in the Word. And if he had to put it in the Word, it would be a mystery hidden and unknown. None of us could even begin to make this up. So we believe by the faith that this book, the Word of God, is true, and these things are going to happen in the time that God has appointed. It could be imminently today, or it could be 100 years from today. We do not know. But it's by faith we believe it, and we have hope that it's going to happen. How long have you hoped for things? Is there any earthly things you've hoped for a long time? You know, you've sat there and say, I really wish, I really hope that I could get a better job. I really wish or I really hope that this would happen. Or I'm really just waiting and I can't, you know, hardly wait for this to happen. And we're hoping and we're hoping and we're hoping. And when it finally happens, we feel like we should throw a party, shouldn't we? Think of the party when all those who believed on the Lord had faith and trust to believe these verses are true and waited and waited and waited and who knows how much longer waited, and all of a sudden it comes to pass. I don't think this phrase, death will be swallowed up in victory, is strong necessarily enough to tell us what's going to happen, the joy. And we won't be worried about the little situation he saved us out of while we were down here. This will be just complete joy for the fulfillment of the faith and the hope of all of those of us who've believed in Christ. You know, I read an interesting story talking about air and flying, and it kind of fits in that way. In Dublin, Ireland, the Dublin Airport Authority began to receive noise complaints at increasing numbers. However, upon researching the issue, almost all of the complaints were from one person who lived near the airport. At a rate of 30-plus written complaints a day in 2021, this one person submitted over 12,000 written complaints to the Dublin airport about the noise. Closely calculated to almost when every plane went out, they wrote out a complaint and mailed it to the airport. Now, the reaction, what would the reaction to that be? They stopped flying planes, right? Nope, that's not the reaction. They ignored it. Of course, they said, there's going to be noise. We are an airport. If you are really bugged by the noise from jets, do not move into a neighborhood right next door to the airport. It didn't affect their operations and their flights one bit. And today we have people who hear the coming of the Lord and they say, oh, yeah, that's that stuff the Christians believe. And if you're going to be a Christian, it's great for you, but, you know, doesn't matter to me, and they ignore it. And for those who ignore it and say, it's nothing I want to think about, nothing I want to deal with, you know, this coming in the air thing, oh, that's a Christian thing. They are the ones who, in their lack of faith and belief and lack of faith in the Lord, are going to find the most disruption and interruption in their lives, as they are still here and the whole world has changed. Those of us who are believers in Christ, we're going to receive a wonderful interruption as we are caught together in the air with our Lord, and death is swallowed up in victory. The fears of life, the problems of life, the difficulties, the struggles, all ended as we meet the Lord and all of his believers, dead and alive alike, through the ages of the church. And so the next verse, verse 55, says, oh, death, where is thy sting? You know what we'll say that day? There is no sting in death. We've lost that sting. We've avoided that sting because we are now with the Lord. In verse 57, the summary verse, but thanks be to God which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. There's coming a victory. There's coming a day when this will take place. And if you know Christ as your Savior and you've believed the gospel that Jesus came to this earth the first time to die upon the cross to forgive your sin, and you believe that sincerely in your heart by your faith, not by your parents' faith or your girlfriend's faith or your boyfriend's faith or your family's faith, but by your faith, and you believe that sincerely, you will be joining those who go to be with him. We look for that day. We hope for that day, not to get us out of the mess we're in today, but because finally, at one point in time, the faith and hope that we've had for however many years it's been, we will say, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, what a wonderful day it will be. That's the day that's coming next. That's the day that's next on God's plan for earth. And it's imminent, as we talked about last week. And next week we'll talk about what does it mean for this earth when we're all, poof, gone. What does that mean? We'll get to that next week. But rejoice this week, because if you think there's a problem you've got, a situation you have that is beyond the ability of the God of heaven to deal with, remember, the God of heaven's going to have the power to come back and pull us all up and meet in the air with us. And if he can do that, what can't he do for you? Let's pray. Father, we ask today that if we're believers in Christ and that we know you as Savior, that we will hold not to an escape pattern, that someday you're coming to help us escape, but that we will hold to the interpretation and application of this passage, that today, without escape, you can give to me everything I need to live for you, to follow you, to obey you, to have you in my life, to direct my life in such a way that you help me with my struggles, you help me with the difficulties, and that your empowerment through the Holy Spirit is in the midst of what I'm doing today, before you come. And so we thank you for that interpretation, that application, and may we leave here this week remembering that the victory is found in Christ, and that victory is for us, not just on a day we'll meet in the air, but it's for today. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a song to sing. It's going to be coming through the sound system. It's a video. It's called Glorious Day. And we'll end on that one this morning. As soon as we wind it up and put it out, we can all stand together as we close.
Came forward to be born of a virgin, dwelt among
glorious day comes by next Sunday, I will not be speaking. And you won't be here. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the promise that we believe by faith of a glorious day that's coming as described by the scripture, and we believe it by faith because I didn't invent it, nor somebody didn't dream it up, but you inspired the authors of scripture, including Paul, who we read from today, to share a mystery with us that we could not know in any other way, and we simply believe it by faith and trust that what you have said will happen. We don't know when. It could be today. It could be this week. It could be weeks and weeks and months from now. We don't know, but help us to live, even as we thought of last week, in the light of your coming, and help us today to rejoice and to have faith and to have hope and belief that there's coming a victory, even though maybe today in our lives we don't feel like there's a victory at all. Help us to live on the side of faith and hope and victory, for we find it in Christ, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.